Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Level Up, Update, by Dan Sugralinov and Max Lagno. Narrated by Ramon de Ocampo. Chapter 1. UFC. Solving big problems is easier than solving little problems. Sergey Brin. Mike Bjornstad Hagen was standing before a mirror in one of the sports complex's gyms. The crowd was roaring outside. The ring announcer was shouting something, and the music blared, interfered by advertising jingles. Mike touched his face with a hand covered in elastic bandages. What could have happened? He thought. Was it me? Or wasn't it? There were other fighters in the locker room, too. Some of them applying bags of ice to injured knees, others taking selfies. There was even a video blogger scurrying around, followed by a cameraman. He would approach the athletes out of the blue, anyone who was free, and ask silly questions in a clownish manner. The rather nosy guy refrained from approaching Hagen, though. Luke Lucas, the producer, had warned him that if he bothered anyone preparing for battle, he would lose his backstage pass for good. And yet, Hagen needed no bloggers to ask himself silly questions. Why did he feel like he'd been swapped for another person since the very morning? Or perhaps it felt as if he had lost something. But what could it possibly be? Confidence? Wasn't he the one who fought in every battle and made it to the top? He couldn't have made it without confidence. Could this mood be the result of his recurring dreams of fighting monsters on some other planet? Hagen even went to see an analyst about it, who'd only reassured him by saying, Everything's perfectly simple, Mr. Hagen. Your unconscious shows you scenarios in a metaphoric language in your sleep. However, in your case, we don't even need any metaphors. You fight monsters asleep and awake. Why did I even have to go to see him in the first place? Hagen thought. Mom used to take me to all sorts of analysts, too, who'd always come up with the same kind of incomprehensible gobbledygook. And yet now, as he was about to enter his decisive battle, Mike wished to hear the calm and confident voice of his therapist. Those people could really calm one down, after all.
Hey, bro. How are you doing? Gonzalo asked him.
Mike's friend of old, Gonzalo Herrera, was the very person who'd once seen Mike's potential and brought him into the world of sparring for cold, hard cash. He'd been living in Las Vegas at that point, too, and was in the business of recruiting fighters who showed promise.
Okay, I guess. Hey, won't you take a look at this?
The screens hanging on the walls of the locker room showed a transmission from the ring. The camera paused on the famous Khabib, who was about to enter the VIP section.
He's really interested in your fight. Do you have any idea what that means, bro?
I sure do. I'm his most likely opponent in the nearest future.
Yup, either you or Molimo. Whichever of you becomes the next rising star is decided today. If you're interested in the betting odds...
Hagen looked behind Gonzalo's shoulder as if to see something unusual there. Ever since the morning, he'd been noticing that he'd kept looking at some point above his interlocutor's head. The hotel administrator's bald patch. The turban on the Uber driver's head. Gonzalo's cap. Why would that be? The shrink would definitely know, and if he didn't, he'd still explain it to him and calm him down.
All right, I'll go see my other fighters, Gonzalo said, having noticed that Hagen wasn't listening.
The video blogger and his operator deliberately stood in such a way they could get Hagen on camera. Mike turned around and headed toward the exit.
It was time to win.
Hagen had seen lots of locker rooms over the last couple of years. He'd walked the distance between the doors and the ring many times. He'd shaken the hands reaching out for him 1,000 times and seen his face on enormous screens and billboards 1,000 times more. He'd even sign his pictures, decorating his autographs with a bear's paw symbol. It was Gonzalo's idea, who told him,
Bro, you've got to be original, even when you sign your photographs.
Occasionally, Mike would fail to believe his own near stardom. He was saddled with several fans who'd created a dedicated social network profile. Strangers had started to get really intrusive in what concerned his personal life. They'd somehow get hold of his phone number and would either message him to congratulate him on his victory or asked him to teach them how to fight like him. Former convicts would write him about their experiences inside, while young gang members asked him for advice on how to behave if they got locked up. Hagen would change his number, but the fans kept pestering him incessantly. Either them or outright psychos. This level of public exposure had obviously affected Mike's behavior in the ring greatly. His attentive fans followed Mike's every move and interpreted everything in their own way. For instance, Hagen developed a new habit. After each victory, he would hastily whisper a few words, pressing his fingers to his lips. Some thought he was praying, while others insisted he was reading spells of the sort that would help him win. And yet, Hagen was only saying, "Look at what I've become, Mom. Thank you." He was already past the period when he'd been accusing his mother of his every misfortune. She'd just been doing everything she could to protect him, and it had never been her intent to cause him such harm by caring excessively. However, something was different now. Hagen no longer felt the protection of the invisible power that had gotten him through training, street fights, sparring in the ring, the conviction, the jail, more sparring. How could he have managed to get through it all? As he was approaching the octagonal UFC ring, he felt the long-forgotten fear. Not the usual caution that any fighter would feel preparing to face an opponent. This was all-consuming dread. Just like back in the day when Goretzky would shout at him and wave his fists around, or when other children had bullied him in his childhood. He suddenly felt indignant. What the hell was going on with him? "Let's fight!" Hagen shouted, throwing punches at the air and running through the last couple of feet to the ring. This antic helped him get out of his strange state of stupor. It would all be okay. His opponent entered the ring at the same time. Molimo Hip Foster, a Native American from South Dakota, was a favorite of the qualifying fights, just like Hagen. They shared more than weight. Many facts of their respective biographies corresponded as well. Like Hagen, Molimo had never been much of an athlete. All he would do was sit in his father's shop and sell authentic Native American souvenirs, actually manufactured in China, to gullible tourists. But then he suddenly got interested in martial arts and made a stellar career over a very short time, from small local amateur contests to statewide championships. This is how he'd gotten into the qualifying matches after having been seen by one of the recruiters. But that wasn't the only thing they had in common. The word Molimo stood for a bear who creeps in the shadows, in the Miwok language. One of the sports commentators even quipped about there never having been any nickname in the entire history of sport that would be so at odds with the athlete's appearance. For instance, the only thing that resembled a bear in Mike Bjorn Hagen was his tattoo, whereas Molimo looked more like a mongoose, agile, fast, and precise. Both fighters were lean and nimble. Both had a good technique. They both preferred hitting the opponent to grappling or foot sweeps. Eventually, journalists started calling Mike and Molimo the M&Ms. They were two fighters who had appeared out of nowhere and became the most fascinating fighting duo at the UFC qualification fights.
"Are you okay?"
The referee's question caught Hagen unawares. Was it so obvious that something weird was going on that even others could see it? Mike took a look at the audience. There was Uncle Peter, beaming proudly at his nephew. He had a t-shirt with Bjorn's portrait on. Hagen was not yet a celebrity enough for his face to be printed on garments, but Gonzalo went out of his way to make a copy for everybody. Another person shifting from foot to foot was Wei Ming, another friend from Mike's earlier years. They used to work together at the repair shop back in the day. Then, he'd moved to Chuck's bar to work as a bouncer. Wei Ming's impenetrable face didn't betray any anxiety, but he was also proud of Mike, They'd faced each other in the ring last week. It was a tough fight, but Mike had still managed to win. And yet, why were the details of the battle so hazy? How exactly had he won? What moves had he used? What were those strange combos? Hagen shook his head. No matter how hard he tried, he couldn't figure out how he'd managed that series of brilliant punches and kicks that had knocked out his friend.
So? Are you okay?
The referee became tensed.
Why aren't you answering?
Hagen looked at the referee and nodded.
Yes, sir.
Let's fight. Okay, then.
Hagen decided against requesting for the match to be postponed due to health issues. He felt okay. Too much depended on this battle for it to be postponed indefinitely. The judge showed the fighters to their corners. The door of the cage closed, and the audience went even wilder. Hagen took a last look at Olga, a judo fighter from Ukraine. He'd met her after his fight with Wei Ming. She was sitting next to his uncle and wore the t-shirt with Hagen's face in a most fetching manner. It felt weird. Why could he remember every second he'd spent with Olga and everything they'd done in that hotel room, but couldn't for the life of him recollect any of the details of his fight with Wei Ming? The referee clapped his hands, bringing Hagen out of his reverie. The world disappeared, as it always did in such cases, with nothing left but Hagen and his opponent. It became a habit with him to become absolutely focused, only leaving this state once the round was over. However, his concentration was marred by irrelevant reflecting yet again. So, I should at least remember how I'd planned to defeat him. I did have a plan, after all. I'd been intending to use some move, and a cunning one at that. The agile Molimo was already approaching him, preparing to attack. He was taller and had wider shoulders, and his kicks defied the statistics of efficiency, knocking out many opponents. A quick attack on the legs and take the whole battle to ground level? Was that how he'd planned to surprise Molimo? No, it was something else. What was that move called, anyway? Strategic delay? Not really. Tactical pause? It must have been that. But what kind of a pause? And what was he doing trying to recollect its name, anyway? Molimo moved in a relaxed manner, holding his hands low, a real mongoose ready to pounce, and yet his behavior looked weird, too. He also seemed uncertain of his actions. Hagen's body jerked automatically, reacting to his opponent's feint. He felt himself lucky to have escaped it. The audience booed disappointedly. They'd all noted the strange behavior of the fighters. It was as if it were their first time in the ring.
Who the hell fights like that?
A face from the front row shouted. Even my grandma could dodge a punch like that. Hagen saw the coach who'd been hired by Luke Lucas stare at him in bewilderment. Gonzalo stood right next to him and looked at the ring with equal amazement. Khabib must have been watching the debacle from the VIP section above. It was time to counterattack. Hagen threw his signature punch. He could clearly hear the loud sound of the audience going, "Oh!" This would normally happen when he would make a particularly strong and precise attack. However, instead of the euphoria of victory, he felt something else. The endless sound of the gong in his head. Hagen's back slammed into the walls of the cage. The floor with the enormous U on it suddenly became a lot closer, and he fell into it as if it was a bottomless pit.
"It's a knockout!"
was the last thing he heard. "Is this my second knockout?" he thought, before falling into the void of the giant letter U. Chapter 2. FUC. In the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Martin Luther King, Jr. Hagen already knew he was lying on a hospital bed a minute before coming to his senses. However, his consciousness was reluctant to return to reality from the world of his dreams. His head was aching, and he could see the spinning UFC logo in his mind's eye, the very one he'd seen just before hitting the floor. The letters weren't standing in one place. They kept spinning and changing places. When they turned into F-U-C, Hagen opened his eyes and sighed loudly.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, you can say that again, bro.
Gonzalo was sitting on a chair near the wall, fidgeting with his mobile phone. Hagen rose in his bed. Did he hit me so hard I ended up at the hospital?
You got hit hard enough. Gonzalo posed for a moment and added, I wouldn't say you got hit all that hard. Molimo could have struck you way harder.
Gonzalo halted for a moment, which made Hagen realize that he'd stopped himself short of saying that Hagen himself could have fought better too.
That's not why you're in hospital, bro.
What's the matter with me?
Gonzalo rose from his chair, approached Hagen, and asked quietly,
Bro, just don't you lie to me. Do you use...
drugs?
Hagen gasped in indignation.
Never. You know well enough I don't even like painkillers.
Gonzalo turned on his phone and showed Mike the YouTube video of their fight. Molimo might have seemed a formidable opponent to Hagen in the ring, but when he took a good look at him, he could clearly see that the Native American walked like a chicken, throwing his fists about as if they were chicken wings. Not that Hagen was any better. He ducked to dodge an attack, frightened, and then got a random hit in the jaw with his opponent's knee. As Hagen fell face first onto the letter U, Molimo grabbed at his leg and limped back towards the ropes. The video blogger from the locker room provided the commentary.
Well, there's nothing one can really say. Who are these sacks of shit? Could this be the unsinkable and incredibly fast Mike Hagen? Could this be the nimble Molimo? They look like parodies of themselves. These are no bears. These are teddies at best, still crashing after their last party. My opinion, ladies and gentlemen, is that we have witnessed a swindle of some sort. Characteristically enough, no producer would provide a reply to any of my questions. These two dark horses have turned into two dirty, corrupt secrets.
Afterwards, the video cut to a scene with Khabib's reaction to the short and pathetic fight. The Russian fighter laughed and said he hadn't had as much fun in a long time. Then he grew serious and said that drugs had destroyed many talented athletes, finally wishing Hagen and Molimo to get over their problems and get back into the ring.
So that's how it goes, bro,
Gonzalo said as he put his phone away.
All right, let me call the doctor. He has a lot to explain to you.
Gonzalo exited the ward. Uncle Peter's worried face appeared from behind the open door, but the doctor, who was just coming in, asked him to wait. So now, even Hagen's uncle would consider his nephew an addict. The doctor showed Hagen his clipboard with x-rays and tables of some sort.
I could tell you a bit of good news right away.
You're an amazingly clean athlete. No traces of any narcotics have been found in your blood. You haven't even been taking any of the legal ones.
Why do you think I took any drugs in the first place? We were checked before entering the ring, after all.
Nobody knows what may have happened, or why both fighters could have changed so much. There were versions implying sabotage. It has been alleged that someone might have poisoned you or added tranquilizers to your drinking water. None of the versions cut the mustard.
So did you find one that did?
The doctor opened a table on his clipboard.
What happened was an unprecedented degradation of your physical condition. I don't know how to explain it, but take a look at your statistics for today and for 2 days ago. Your muscle mass has been reduced almost by half. In fact, it is incredible, but you have even grown shorter. There is no existing medical explanation. I wouldn't have believed it, but I took those measurements myself.
Once Hagen tried to read the statistics in the table, he got a headache. He put away the clipboard.
Doc, could you give me a painkiller, please?
Mike, you are the only fighter I know that has strictly forbidden me from giving you painkillers. And I've seen you often enough after fights with horrendous bruises and even broken ribs. But you could take it, and everything would heal incredibly fast every time. As for now,
Doc! My head is killing me, Mike howled. While the medic was rummaging around in a drawer, Hagen once again looked toward some spot above the doctor's Isaac Hayes-like head, with just a fringe of gray hair around it. Did he expect to see a hint of some sort there? The doctor gave him an injection, and the pain went away. Hagen slumped onto his pillow. Once the agony had abated, he asked,
What's happening to me, Doc?
I've no idea,
the doctor said, in an unexpectedly mirthful tone.
It's absolutely out of the ordinary, Mike. I've seen your medical chart, and if we don't consider your physical condition's sudden degradation, you're absolutely healthy. Well, as healthy as a year ago, that is. A little concussion after the knockout has got nothing to do with it.
Does that mean I can get back to fighting then? Mike was overcome by a rush of inexplicable optimism once his head hurt no more.
You might have, had they let you.
But
just get better first, and then you'll decide if you want back. Do you remember how the fight ended? If I were you, I'd have a rest, go to a beach or a casino maybe. Forget about fighting for a while at least.
The doctor let Hagen know they would say no more about it, but didn't leave the ward.
There's another thing, Mike. I'm sorry to tell you this, but Luke Lucas refused to foot your hospital bills, so you're the one who'll end up paying them.
Come again? Why?
Sorry, but I have nothing to do with that. I just wanted to let you know.
The doctor gave Hagen a cheerful smile as he departed. Physical anguish became replaced by the anguish of the soul.
It would be about money, wouldn't it?
Damn, he'd stake nearly everything he had on his victory. And Gonzalo had made his bets, too. Likewise, Wei Ming and Uncle Peter. Fuck. Uncle Peter had even convinced his vet friends to take part in the affair. Mike remembered vaguely that even Chuck Morrison had been convinced to place a bet. Nevertheless, the invincible Mike Bjorn Hagen had lost in the most mysterious and preposterous manner. But lose, he had. His whole career had been rendered in a short video that went viral on YouTube. When Gonzalo showed him his phone, he saw that the number of views had already exceeded 6 digits. His plan had been to become a great fighter. He'd become the object of great ridicule instead. The fight that Molimo didn't fight well either was hardly any consolation. At least the Native American had managed to win. On the other hand, it was odd why Molimo himself had fought like a newbie. The painkiller's effects set in, and Hagen got lost in a convoluted trail of thought resembling a daydream. He felt as though he were on an unknown planet himself. However, this time, there was no fighting and no monsters. Just an empty field and the ruins of some futuristic construction lit by the enormous crimson ball of an alien sun about to disappear behind the horizon. Hagen instantly recalled the analyst's words. Could it be that he no longer had to fight when there were no monsters anymore? Could sunset be the symbol of Hagen's losing to his own unrecognized monsters? His thoughts of the shrink eventually brought Hagen to thoughts about money. They weren't happy thoughts. He had none. He had indeed received some money from Mr. Riggs, an old cop working as a security officer at the same shop as Mike and Wei Ming. That particular time, Riggs had managed to get Mike compensated for $30,000, representing his interests for emotional distress. However, Mike had bet all the remaining funds on his own victory. The motel and gym were paid for by Luke Lucas, who had considered him a fighter with a future who would eventually return the investment. Well, he hadn't. His painkiller-addled mind went through the sequence of all the months spent in Las Vegas training, fighting, and training again. He kept on winning. He would sometimes lose, but he would win more often. And it was Hagen's big head that had caused him to convince his friends to bet as much as they could on him. Gonzalo didn't have to be asked twice. He was always ready to take a chance. Wei Ming had objected, though. He kept telling Mike he didn't believe in gambling. Mike's arrogant reply the last time had been,
"Do you believe in me?"
Wei Ming didn't deny it.
"I kinda do."
"Then pay it no attention and wager it all. I'm sure of my victory," Mike exclaimed, patting his friend on the shoulder. Given that Mike would most often win, Wei Ming eventually allowed Mike to convince him and agreed reluctantly.
So what could have happened?
Hagen woke up. Uncle Peter stood in front of his bed, with Wei Ming behind him and Gonzalo not far behind. The morning light filled the hospital ward.
"Mikey, could you please explain what happened?"
his uncle asked again.
"The doctor said you were dying."
Since Hagen was yawning at the time, he froze, just like that, with his jaw dropped.
"Uncle, I'm nowhere near dead. I've just had my physical parameters decline."
"Is that any better?"
Hagen wanted to reply. He looked at all of his friends. For the first time in a long time, he was close to tears. Imagine letting everybody down like that. His friends must have read his feelings loud and clear, since everybody started to reassure him and say money was their least concern.
"I'll learn a lot more. You can make money out of thin air in Las Vegas. I found two fighters, and I am about to expand my business,"
Gonzalo claimed.
"I can find a part-time job at a Chinese restaurant," Wei Ming said curtly. "Also, Gonzalo offered me to join his team."
Hagen's uncle just waved his hand and patted him on the head the way he had when his nephew was little. And this was considering that he must have lost the most, having remortgaged a house he had paid a full mortgage for. Hagen had plenty of words of kindness and gratitude to say to everyone, but he could only manage a few simple words of politeness.
"Thank you. Is there any chance of spending some time on my own?"
Wei Ming simply nodded and exited.
"Hey, bro,
were you thinking we'd spend the rest of the day babysitting you?"
Gonzalo said with contrived joviality.
"We're all busy men here."
He dropped a mobile phone and a set of keys on Hagen's bed. "I brought your phone and drove your car over."
"Thanks.
Olga told me to say hi,"
Gonzalo said before exiting.
"Where is she?"
"She's gone back to Russia or wherever. Her competition is over."
"Ukraine, not Russia."
"Same difference."
Gonzalo went out. Hagen's uncle moved to a chair.
"As for me, I'm not going anywhere."
Hagen sat down upon the bed.
"Uncle, do you remember the time you returned from Iraq?"
"When would that be? I served there twice and came back both times. The first time was in 1990...
"When I was little," Mike interrupted impatiently.
"You've always been little. To me, you're still a young lad."
"That's not what I'm talking about. Will you please listen? Do you remember the family dinner in celebration of your return? The time you stood up and walked out?"
Hagen's uncle frowned.
"But how does this relate to...
Look, I want to stay on my own now, too. Can you understand that? Just the way you did that time."
Uncle Peter stood up, looking offended, walked out, and shut the door behind him without saying a single word. Once Mike had unblocked his phone, he found a bunch of unread messages and letters. Some of them needed to be answered immediately. He opened his messenger and found the message from his promoter, which he mulled over a few times.
"Lucky Luke. I don't know what underhanded game you might be playing, son, but you've gone too far. They used to kill people for less back in my day. I advise you to stay out of my sight. I don't need your bullshit excuses. Everything's clear. Just remember one thing. You won't ever fight again for as long as I'm alive. And I'll stay alive for a long, long time. Much longer than a bastard like you. Another thing. Any business relationship that we may have had is over. My attorney will take care of reclaiming everything I've spent on your ungrateful ass. Have a bad day."
This was followed by the app's notification saying this user had blocked Hagen and that no reply would be possible. Mike nearly let the phone slip out of his hands. What the hell was that? What had he done? He'd only lost a single battle. It was bad, sure, but considering how many times he'd won before, it would just fall into the category of statistical error. Could that be the reason for so much animosity? He spent a few hours trying to reach Lucas via third parties, sending dozens of messages to whoever he could reach. However, the only thing he managed to learn was that he'd managed to piss off nearly the entire clique of promoters, and not just Lucas. Hagen opened his fighter's profile at some unofficial site, feeling desperate. Mike Bjornstad Hagen. Nickname, Bjornstad. Style, boxing, kickboxing, punching, resilience. Victories, defeats, draws, 12-1-0. Age, 30. Height, 5.5 feet. Weight, 152 pounds. Arm span, 6 feet. Leg span, 3.3 feet. Obviously, the statistics only involved Hagen's fights in the preliminary contest. He shuddered as he recalled the fights in the wooden ring back in the prison. Compared to those, mixed martial arts had a very strict code. How could he have survived it all? He'd been very lucky that Blinky Palermo, who'd run the prison and had intended to destroy Mike in the wooden ring, had fallen prey to a heart attack. Otherwise, he'd never have left the prison. Fortune was on his side sometimes after all. Yet he had no wish to revisit the experience. Hagen checked the data from the doctor and came to the conclusion that, odd as it might seem, his body had reverted to roughly the same shape it had before he'd started on martial arts. He rose from the bed, assumed the standard boxing stance in front of the mirror, and looked at his reflection in the mirror skeptically, hospital attire and all. It seemed that the positions of his arms and legs were okay. Mike suddenly remembered how Ochoa, his old coach, had used to teach him to breathe with his hands. Nothing has changed since. Hagen threw a few punches, but he instantly became sweaty, his limbs leaden. Could he have gotten tired so quickly? His heart throbbed so hard it felt it could leave his chest any second. But he wouldn't need any opponents now anyway. He heard the door open. The doctor entered the ward. He gave a throat cough as he saw his patient in a battle stance.
Impatient, eh? Never mind, you'll be out in a few hours, but I strongly advise against sports. You can jog a little or do some yoga, but forget about anything along the lines of boxing or karate.
Hagen sat down in his bed. Have you found out what could have happened to me? The doctor moved his chair closer to the bed and sat down opposite his patient.
Mr. Hagen, Mike, I have to confess that nothing like this has ever happened in my practice before.
Anybody else's practice, then?
Perhaps and perhaps not. That's exactly what I wanted to talk to you about.
The doctor proceeded to offer Hagen participation in a special clinical program offering free checkups and treatment for patients with cases unknown to science. I don't get it. Hagen looked surprised. How are you going to treat me if you don't have a diagnosis?
We'll experiment, collect data, and look for approaches,
the doctor went on monotonously. Does that mean I'll become your guinea pig? Mike interrupted him.
You don't have to put it that way.
The doctor looked embarrassed for a moment.
Although you could put it that way. However, you'll receive compensation for your participation in the program.
Mike didn't think long. The experimental program wouldn't cover all his medical expenses, but he would at least owe less. Hagen signed the contract without thinking too long. Once the doctor was out, Hagen grabbed his phone and took another look at his boxer's stats at the site. Weight, skills, victories, and the like resembled the stats of a video game. But there was something else. What else could it be? He couldn't remember. Chapter 3. Lost Wages. Beauty is mysterious as well as terrible. God and devil are fighting there, and the battlefield is the heart of man. Fyodor Dostoevsky. It took Hagen half an hour to find his car at the parking lot. Gonzalo hadn't even said where exactly he'd left it. Mike even wanted to give him a call, but then changed his mind. He felt too embarrassed to talk to any of his friends at that moment. The episode with his uncle had really made him cringe. It was as though he'd chased him away. He'd need to apologize, but that would have to wait. His current priority was going to the motel and pondering his further life choices. Professional competition was out of the question for a while, clearly enough. The worst thing, though, was that Hagen wasn't certain whether he could compete again, given his unknown ailment. The doctor had told him that he might try to train again, but only in a week or two, so Mike had no idea what to do in the meantime. He kept circling around the rows of cars until he finally found the dark blue Ram 1500, which he'd once bought from his sworn enemy, Greg Goretzky. Once he'd got to Las Vegas, he'd made sure to put a layer of paint over the pictures of nudes decorating the pickup truck. Olga had told him it was demeaning to women and in extremely poor taste. Hagen concurred. He never managed to get inside the car. Three young men clad in identical dark jackets, which was rather at odds with the heat, emerged from behind the pickup, surrounding him. They didn't stand too close to him, likely aware of who they were dealing with and reluctant to taste his fists. One of the three whispered to his friend in Portuguese,
"Are you sure it's this one? He looks too pale and too short." "That's him, all right," answered the other one, scrutinizing Hagen.
Mike had picked up a few phrases in Portuguese in jail from Brazilian inmates, and this knowledge now came in handy.
"Oi," he said, "como vai vocês?"
Mike noticed that there was another young man standing at the turn leading to the parking on the lookout for the cops, and a few more were waiting in a nearby car. Life in prison, and life in general, had taught him to keep his cool in situations like this one. Had they intended to kill him, they wouldn't have bothered with formalities.
"Hey, guys," Mike repeated in English this time. "How may I help you?"
One of the young men leaned toward his companion.
"He seems too polite to be an evil spirit. The devil wears many masks."
Finally, a young woman with long hair, all dressed in black, stepped out from a nearby car. Her neck was adorned with necklaces of different colors, which dangled as she walked. There was a small but deep scar on the woman's left cheek, and a small tattoo descending all the way down her neck and disappearing under the necklace coils. Her full bright red lips gave her a sinister look, coupled with her gleaming dark eyes. She stopped a few steps away from Mike and said, with a slight Latino accent,
"Esteban wants to talk to you."
"Thanks, but I've just been discharged from the hospital. I really need some rest."
Hagen took a step toward his car. "Also, I don't know anyone called Esteban. Sorry." The young men stepped back, but kept him surrounded. Hagen took his hands out of his pockets, clenched his fists, and cracked his knuckles. He really wanted to crack his neck, too, just for the sake of intimidation, but he appeared to have lost that ability. He knew he wouldn't even be able to take out the tattooed woman. He was just bluffing, and bluffing only worked on cowards. The guy who'd been asking his friend questions crossed himself and shrank aside. His companion pulled him back by the hand. Hagen buckled up and took another step toward the car. The thugs gave him a wide berth. They even let him open the door. Then everything happened so quickly that Mike didn't even manage to grasp the full meaning of it. The scarred beauty appeared right in front of him and poked his shoulder with a taser. With a cracking sound, a spasm of pain rolled over his body. She tased him again, this time in the neck. Hagen fell into the arms of his captors. With a screeching of brakes, the car she'd emerged from stopped right in front of them all. Hagen's arms and legs were still convulsing. They placed him on the back seat and shut the door. He wasn't in command of his body and instantly fell to the floor. He didn't see the woman sit down on the seat and place her feet on him, but he certainly felt it. The car left the parking lot, staying well within the legal speed limit. The scared gang member in the front seat kept on whispering about the devil.
"Shut up.
the woman snapped. Can't you see that the devil is weak? He's in our hands.
Someone twisted his arms and tied them together with a thin wire that hurt him whenever he moved, cutting into his wrists. Then they put a dark bag over his head, twisting it so that it almost gagged him. They rummaged through his pockets and took away his phone. It all happened so quickly he didn't even panic. He was too overwhelmed to feel fear anymore. They drove for a long time. Occasionally, they'd stop at a traffic light or in a jam. Hagen heard them slow down at a toll highway gate once. Judging by how their ride became bumpy later on, they must have taken a back road at some point. Mike could smell the dust through the bag's fabric. They must have been somewhere outside the city limits. Finally, he was lifted off the floor and forced to sit down, but the bag remained on his head. At any rate, he wouldn't have been able to tell how long it had taken them to get there. He'd passed out a few times. The tased parts of his body, his neck and his shoulder hurt like hell. He had a headache, too, his whole body stiff and achy, his back, his legs, his arms. He was absolutely parched, too. Mike's kidnappers hadn't mentioned anything that could make his destiny clearer. They would just discuss whether to turn left or right without naming any streets. At some point, Hagen felt like he'd recovered somewhat, so he tried to wriggle and kick. An elbow in his chest nearly made him choke, so he went limp. His battle spirit snuffed out. The car finally stopped. The engine was turned off. Mike could hear the doors slamming. Then he was dragged outside. Someone removed the bag from his head. His legs fell asleep, so he couldn't help falling on the sand, covered in prickly vines of some sort. It was late at night, but Hagen still squinted at the car's headlights and the street lamps nearby. He could see a part of a wooden fence with carpets drying upon it. He gulped the air thirstily after all the hours spent with his head in the bag. He tried to say something, but his lips didn't obey him, and his dry throat could only manage a hoarse squeak. Hagen was picked up again and dragged across the sand. Another detail he barely managed to register was a wooden veranda of a small cabin illuminated by the crimson strip of sunset and halfway obscured by rocks. There was a smell of burning wood and horse manure. The bravos that had kidnapped him forced him onto a chair. The door slammed behind them. The only person to remain was the woman with a scar on her face who sat down at the table right across from him. The cabin's interior reminded Hagen of the hunting lodge where he'd once spent a weekend with Uncle Peter. That was back in the day when Mike had been working for his uncle's video surveillance system company in Seattle. At the time, Peter had had another brainwave as to how he could make his nephew man up, so he took him on a hunting trip. It was winter, so Hagen pretended to be sick and spent both days inside the lodge without venturing out once. While his uncle hunted, he would play games on his phone, then climb up to the attic, where there was internet coverage to banish his demons, his slang for masturbation, which he'd already grown tired of by watching porn. The fire crackled in the fireplace. The wall on the right looked menacing, with a whole bunch of shotguns and knives mounted upon it. A large wooden table stood in front of him. Had Hagen paid the owners a visit without a sack on his head, he would have appreciated the coziness of this functional minimalism. "Some water?" Hagen barely managed to get the words out of his parched throat, coveting all the empty mugs and bowls. The woman took a bottle of water out of a pack that stood on a windowsill and helped him quench his thirst. His hands remained tied. The way she touched Hagen's cheek was soft and almost gentle, which seemed to make her even more dangerous somehow.
"Baby Mikey, also known as Cry Baby, also known as Blue Eyes, also known as Bjorn," said a voice with a strong Hispanic accent behind his back. "I know all about you, baby Mikey. In fact, I know more about you than anybody else."
"He doesn't look like the devil you're describing," the woman said suddenly, taking her place opposite Hagen. "He didn't even throw a single punch. There was no need to tie this bunny up, let alone tase him. Give him a few slaps, and he'll go wherever you tell him to."
"Looks can be deceptive, Fernanda," the stranger interrupted. "Many of Baby Mikey's opponents made the same mistake and lost."
He moved into Mike's field of view. Mike studied him as he stood closely. Around 35 years old, a little bit of spare tire under the black leather jacket squeezed into a white t-shirt, massive rings on his fingers, a golden chain around his neck. The man was large and had a wide frame. One could easily spot a fighter who had abandoned competitions for gluttony. He sat down next to the woman and peered at Hagen. The man's eyes seemed to drill into his very soul, which suddenly made him actually scared.
"Remember me?"
the stranger asked. Hagen shook his head. "No." It must have been the wrong answer. The stranger looked taken aback.
"You mean...
I'm Esteban.
The prison, the wooden ring.
What do you mean you don't remember? We fought twice. I refused the third time, since you nearly killed me the previous one."
"I fought many people there, and there were many people I'd nearly killed."
"But there was no nearly in the case of Blinky Palermo, eh?"
The stranger chuckled.
"You totally killed him."
Hagen looked at Esteban with unfeigned surprise. The director of the prison died of a heart attack. No one killed him.
"Didn't I tell you I knew more about you than you know yourself?"
Esteban kept showing off his knowledge of what he claimed were all the details of Hagen's life. But Mike suddenly became indifferent. The dull pain in his hands, tied behind his back, was replaced by a feeling of numbness. He was no longer sure he had any hands, after all. The walls of the room began to blur. Mike's face hit the table. He came around when Fernanda poured some bottled water over his head. A very surprised Esteban was standing right next to her.
"What's the matter with you? Where is your legendary stamina?"
"Untie my hands, please," Mike asked.
"Untie your hands?" Esteban grinned. "And let you run amok? Not likely, baby Mikey."
"It really hurts."
The once invincible Hagen's behavior must have confused Esteban. He told Fernanda to untie their prisoner's hands and sat down opposite Mike, placing his gun on the table in front of him.
"Okay, baby Mikey. Let's get down to business.
There are two items on our agenda." "Sure,
whatever," Hagen said. His hands were completely numb. He couldn't move a finger. But as Esteban spoke, he began to pay attention. His captor had left prison shortly after Hagen himself had gotten back into the firearms black market business. Nevertheless, he'd never lost track of Hagen's career.
"I don't know how no one could have noticed it," Esteban said, "but it is completely obvious to me that you're possessed by an evil spirit, which has given you your power and your skill. You've mastered the magic you used to win in the ring, and this was the very magic that killed your number one enemy, Blinky Palermo."
"What are you on about?"
Hagen lost his patience. "What magic?" Esteban grabbed his gun and banged the barrel on the table.
"Don't you get cocky with me. You can't fool me."
He kept going on about how he'd collected all the available information on Hagen's life, eventually finding out that his ascension to the championship summit was recent and sudden. Apart from that, every witcher shaman he'd shown Hagen to had confirmed the presence of a spirit from beyond. At that point, Esteban had decided to put his knowledge to good use and would always bet on Hagen.
"And I've never been wrong once," Esteban concluded. "You always won. Yesterday, however."
"I really have no idea how that could have happened," Hagen admitted.
They didn't let him finish. Fernanda gave him an unexpectedly hard slap on the neck.
"No nos descotora, nunca." "I placed my bet on you yesterday," Esteban continued, "and it was a large bet."
Hagen was beginning to get pissed off by his attitude.
"Well, what did you expect? You took a risk and you lost."
"No, I didn't. You did. And guess who you lost to?"
Mike's head swam. He could barely understand what Esteban was talking about. According to him, Hagen had made a deal with a gang supporting Molino, and that he'd taken a dive in the ring for the sole purpose of getting paid. Even Luke Lucas, his promoter, had found out and decided to quit working with a slime bag like him.
But I have no money at all. No one's paid me anything, Hagen barely managed.
He did his best to explain that something strange had happened to him and that he was no longer the invincible fighter. Esteban kept on listening, banging the barrel of his gun over the table so furiously that Hagen was afraid he might shoot himself in the leg.
Shut up! You mean you're no longer possessed by your diabolical power?
Mike could already move his hands, so he made a dismissive gesture.
If that's the way you understand it, then... No, I'm not.
Esteban aimed his gun at him.
Get up!
I said get up! Drag your sorry ass into the middle of the room, and now, fight!
Fight whom? Hagen was surprised for a moment.
Fight her.
Mike raised his arms.
Hey, with all due respect.
But Fernanda went for him so confidently that he was obliged to take a battle stance. She expertly dove under his arms, slid over the floor, grabbed Hagen by his ankles, and smashed him into the floor, pinning him down with her hips. Mike knew a few Brazilian jiu-jitsu moves, even though he didn't use them often in the ring. Not that he could remember any of them now, anyway. Before he knew what had hit him, his body hit the floor again, while Fernanda grabbed Hagen by the heel in a submission hold. The invincible Hagen's cry of pain was so loud that even Esteban cringed. Fernanda could have carried on, but Mike passed out again.
Chapter 4. The Master Fixer.
Don't try to be like Jackie. There is only one Jackie. Study computers instead.
Jackie Chan.
I'm telling you, there's nothing special about him. Even a punch bag fights better than he does.
Don't argue with me, Fernanda. The devil is still inside of him. He's just faking it. He's got to explain his defeat somehow, after all.
It would be much easier if we just killed him,
Fernanda said out of the blue.
Are you nuts?
Esteban whispered in response.
That's all you want to do, is it? You can't just walk around killing people.
Hagen was lying on the floor listening to their conversation. He couldn't see Fernanda, but he could hear her giggle. Gradually, he managed to lift his body just enough to be able to move. His dislocated foot hurt like hell, but somehow he made it to the chair. His kidnappers observed him in silence. Hagen grabbed the bottle of water and took a few greedy gulps. The woman chuckled.
So that's the devil you've been on about. Looks more like a turd to me.
Esteban made a dismissive gesture.
Even if the spirit is asleep, it might awaken one day.
He approached Hagen and spat out in derision.
Don't even bother to think you've managed to trick me.
What do you want from me? Hagen jabbered, crushing the empty bottle in his hands.
I am no devil or demon or a spirit or a wraith.
I don't actually know what I am.
Shut up. I'll explain it to you just who and what you are. You're someone who owes me money. You don't seem to be in your best shape today, but that doesn't cancel your debt.
Hagen laughed out loud, forgetting about his poor condition for a moment.
Didn't you find my wallet when you were searching me? You can take as much as you like.
Esteban had kept his distance all the while, apparently still fearing Hagen's fists. But now he leaped forward and kicked Mike in the chest so hard that he fell, chair and all.
Get rid of him,
Esteban ordered his partner. Hagen was unable to rise. He just lay there, waiting for whatever would come next. He didn't even care whether they killed him or not. Things were getting so overwhelming, he became numb and indifferent. He felt a draft sweep over the floor. Someone must have opened the door. Mike saw his kidnapper's boots. They dragged him out into the street. The night sky was studded with a myriad of twinkling stars. The thugs pulled Hagen up so he could stand, then exited stage left. The only person left was Fernanda.
The Great Basin Highway is that way, she pointed.
Hagen checked his pockets. Where are my car keys?
The car is ours now. It's a right lemon, but we'll find some use for it.
Don't forget one thing. You don't own anything until you've paid off your debt. You belong to Esteban.
But I can't trek across the desert alone. And it's nighttime, for Christ's sake.
If Esteban's right, and there really is an evil spirit inside you, it won't let you die.
There are no spirits in me, either evil or good.
The highway isn't as far as you might think. Quit whining and get going.
Hagen plopped down onto the ground.
I'm not going anywhere.
Would you prefer to stay with Esteban?
Not really, no. But it's a totally harebrained idea to make me trek across the desert.
She grinned and produced her gun.
Would you prefer me to send you elsewhere?
Hagen jumped up at the sight of the firearm.
You keep going on about the devil and evil spirits, but look how evil and cruel you are.
I'd have thought your own company would be enough for you.
She just moved the barrel back and forth.
Hagen turned around and set off into the night, limping.
Make sure you keep going in the same direction, smart guy, Fernanda told him. Straight ahead. You won't get lost.
So Hagen got walking. The vastness of Nevada's starlit sky was spread out above his head in all its glory. The desert around him looked just as vast, with enormous rock silhouettes, pitch black against a dark blue background. Hagen kept dragging his feet across short, prickly weeds, stumbling over rocks and getting his feet caught in rocks on the ground. It was strange how the stars could shine bright enough to blind a lonely traveler in the desert. Mike could see nothing of the terrain, so he felt his way through, barely evading brushes and cacti. Half the sole on his left sneaker had torn off and kept getting caught in the grass. His thin hoodie wasn't windproof. Mike was shivering and felt half frozen, yet he lacked the sheer stamina needed to pick up the pace and get warmer. He'd grown up far to the north and had only seen Nevada's landscapes on pictures or in movies. He couldn't have fathomed how the temperature could change from infernally hot to unbearably cold in such a short time. He felt so weary he couldn't even think about what had happened to him earlier. Kidnapped and nearly killed? Big deal. It didn't feel any better than it had back then. Hagen doubted he could reach the highway alive. What was the purpose of living, for that matter? Hadn't his every attempt to improve things landed him in even deeper trouble? Was plodding through the desert in torn sneakers at night any better than repairing equipment in the Digimart cubicle? Was fighting in the ring and risking getting crippled every time any better than occasionally venturing out into Chuck's bar for a beer or two? Was fighting and getting punched and kicked in the liver and other sensitive parts of his anatomy any better than playing Mortal Kombat and winning, leaving the couch for no other purpose than to grab another packet of chips? He could destroy his liver without any outside help by gorging himself on the kind of tasty food that's supposedly so bad for you. Were any of the girls he'd met since April Connell, the one who departed to Israel, the first one in his life that was actually normal, worthy of all the trouble? There must have been some good chicks around. In any case, girls would always be worth it. Hagen stopped to catch his breath as he stood facing the enormous stars, which were like a silent audience sitting in the dark. This celestial audience expected Hagen to launch a counterattack against his unknown foe. However, Mike Bjorn Hagen, the champion that never was, had decided to turn around and leave the ring. Actually, he didn't know what he would have chosen, but anything would be better than dying in the desert. Hagen lowered his head. Sorry, stars. You've placed your bets on the wrong fighter. It wasn't even a fighter you were betting on in the first place.
He took a few steps forward and almost crashed into some wire mesh. Aha, civilization, finally. As he made his way along the mesh fence, using it for support, he saw lights glitter in the distance. Then more lights. And even more lights. The night seemed to have lit up all of a sudden. Hagen forgot all about his weariness and almost started running toward the lights of vehicles racing in both directions along the Great Basin Highway. Once he'd reached the highway, he still didn't dare to stop. A new fear gripped him. Could Esteban be watching Mike from a distance? Hagen didn't explain it to himself why Esteban would want to follow him across the desert, but he trotted as fast as he could along the side of the road. The oncoming headlights kept blinding him. He'd have to stop and turn his face away every time. A loud honk came from behind. With a deafening screeching of tires, a truck pulled up by the side of the road. The trucker leaned out the window.
Got lost, did you? Where are you running to?
Home.
Where's home, then?
Hagen almost named his hometown, but then checked himself.
Las Vegas? Dude, this highway doesn't lead anywhere but Vegas. Anyway, okay, I get it. Partied hard in the desert, did you? Hop in.
Mumbling his thanks to the driver, Hagen climbed into the truck. The trucker was a chubby man with gray hair and arms so short he could barely hold the jumbo-sized steering wheel. He spun it like the Wheel of Fortune on TV, took in Hagen's state, and chuckled again.
Take a look under the seat. There should be a bottle of water there.
While his passenger was quenching his thirst, the driver didn't ask too many questions, but he was clearly in the mood for conversation. Hagen was immensely grateful to the man who may have saved his life, after all. He very nearly got to the stage of oversharing, about to tell the story of how his ex had run off with a trucker, but prudently kept it to himself. Instead, he told the driver about the new highway built next to his hometown and how it was now a new trucker's hub. The driver nodded.
I've been there once. They have some place there that has the best chicken wings in the States.
He kept talking, throwing the occasional glance at Hagen, telling him that he used to love desert parties with his friends when he was younger.
You get some booze, you get stoned a little. It doesn't get any better than that. You don't even need to get high to start seeing things in the desert.
Hagen shuddered as he remembered the audience of stars gathering above his head. It seemed silly now, but when he'd been making his way through the desert, he'd clearly perceived them as a disappointed audience.
What do you do for a living, anyway?
The man asked. Hagen was sitting there with his head leaning against the glass. He raised his head and mumbled something about having no idea.
Come again? The driver asked. I can't hear you.
Good question. What was he really? A funny fighter from a viral YouTube video? A former convict? Someone enslaved by a magic-crazed gangster?
I'm a repairman. I do computers, vacuum cleaners, that kind of thing.
Hey! The man's face cleared. I have this laptop here, you see. But it's gotten so slow lately I can't watch anything on Netflix, and I hate using my phone for that. Not enough detail, and I like things big.
He didn't elaborate on that, but Hagen could take a hint.
Let me check it.
After a while, they stopped at a diner. The driver fell asleep right on the couch at the table once he'd had his meal, and Mike proceeded with examining the laptop to see what was wrong. Oddly enough, there was no malware. Then, Hagen checked and disassembled the laptop using the toolbox from the truck's glove compartment. The problem was trivial. Too much dust. The laptop was old, and it looked like no one had ever cleaned it before. HD video playback made it overheat and slowed it down. He cleaned and wiped everything inside, even managing to blow the dust out of hard-to-reach places using the hand dryer in the bathroom. The truck driver woke up to the sight of a movie playing in full screen mode. Everything was functioning perfectly, with no lags.
So, does it work?
Changing the thermal paste wouldn't hurt, to tell you the truth.
so you'd still better take it to some service for repairs.
Thanks, man!
You're welcome. I've been doing it all my life, after all.
A true master! You can't hide talent.
Hagen slumped, pondering whether the key to his future could really lie in his past. Chapter 5. Methods and Means. He who knows when he can fight and when he cannot will be victorious. Sun Tzu. Unlike Wei Ming and Mike Hagen, Gonzalo Quila Herrera's performance at the screening tournaments was hardly impressive. However, he'd managed to achieve something else, namely, finding his true vocation. Having lost another fight, he'd struck himself from the list of candidates and switched to managing fighters.
A personal victory is not always necessary to become a champion. You can create an environment where other fighters will win, he told Mike at the time.
But you're a decent fighter, Hagen grew doubtful. Are you sure you want to quit?
What's the point of going on? I'd meet you in the ring sooner or later, and all my chances would be ruined.
Gonzalo hadn't regretted his decision after he'd seen Mike beat 7 barrels of crap out of Wei Ming. Working as a producer, organizing sports-related events, and helping other fighters were the very things Gonzalo specialized in at the Dark Devil Club. And Las Vegas offered much greater opportunities. First, he studied the local market of sports-related showbiz. He defined the niches that hadn't been taken yet, either due to a lack of prospects or simply because no one had thought of exploring that direction yet. He compiled a couple of detailed business plans to account for different development possibilities.
My education sure came in handy, he thought, admiring his plans.
Hagen's role models were Demetrius Johnson and Khabib Nurmagomedov. But one day, Gonzalo had told Hagen,
Luke Lucas is one of the real high rollers. There are great coaches or producers behind every great fighter. I may not have made it as a fighter, but I will make it as someone who creates fighters.
Initially, Luke Lucas had paid no attention to the young upstart who kept on following him all the time, wishing to learn the secrets of the trade from one of the greatest. Gonzalo kept on following him to every event and to every gym during training sessions. One day, Gonzalo became desperate enough to follow the producer all the way to a local Italian restaurant, where Lucas was supposed to have a business lunch. When they reached the entrance, Lucas swung around and grabbed the younger man by the collar.
If I catch you stalking me again, I'll break your legs, get it?
I sure do. That would make following you much more difficult, sir.
Luke Lucas laughed, but his disposition didn't get any sunnier.
You've chosen the wrong way of getting advice about business. Stop stalking me.
I'm sorry, sir, but I'd like to learn from the best.
Luke Lucas let go of him.
When I moved to Vegas from a small town called Cottonwood in Arizona, I only had $120 in my pocket. I had no one to learn from, so I've made my fair share of mistakes. And look at you asking for advice on how to avoid these mistakes.
Gonzalo stood silent for a while. Then he nodded reluctantly.
I read you loud and clear, sir. Thanks for your advice.
Even though Luke Lucas didn't concede to mentor the young producer, he would help him a couple of times. He pointed out a few people he'd thought Gonzalo should get in touch with during tournaments. One day, he even gave him a piece of advice on finding new fighters with talent. And then, just when everything was going peachy, Hagen got defeated in the most bizarre way. Luke Lucas didn't just sever all ties to Mike. He wouldn't return Gonzalo's calls either. He'd made an attempt to track the old man down once again, but Lucas called the cops. Gonzalo got fined for stalking and received a restraining order prohibiting him from approaching the producer again. Another attempt would mean an even bigger fine. It might even land him in jail.
I'd rather he'd just have broken my legs, Gonzalo thought bitterly.
The restraining order limited his business development opportunities even more. Previously, Gonzalo would have used any opportunity to encounter Luke Lucas. Now he did his best to avoid him. Gonzalo was royally pissed off at Hagen for obvious reasons. Mike had managed to tank all of his business plans. Gonzalo last saw Hagen when he'd been discharged from the hospital. It was rather odd that Hagen didn't attempt to get in touch either. He just sent a message with his new address. He moved to the north of Vegas from the hotel to a neighborhood in the vicinity of the Stratosphere Tower. As Gonzalo arrived at the address, he saw a street lined with old, two-story condos that looked as if they had been made of refrigerator packaging. He chuckled. You never know, Lucas himself might have rented an apartment here when he'd first come to Vegas in 78 with only $120 in his pocket. Gonzalo's own beginnings were a lot easier. The locals looked at him with hostility as he made his way from the parking lot to the staircase. There was a group of teens at one end of the street and another one of slightly older guys at the other. The latter were noisier and rowdier than the greenhorns. They had a grill set up outside and kept opening the lid to check whether their food was ready. Gonzalo was happy he'd changed his dressing style completely. No bandanas or check shirts for him anymore. They'd been replaced by shirts, blazers, slacks, and good shoes. Had he turned up here in his old attire, he'd have had to answer all sorts of questions, such as, "Who are you?" or "What are you doing here?" which would inevitably be followed by the suggestion to get the hell out, or else. There was no doorbell or buzzer anywhere near Hagen's door, so he had to pound it with his fist. The cardboard-grade door very nearly came off its hinges. Hagen peeked out to make sure his guest had come unaccompanied, let him in, and hurried to lock the door again. Could he really be so naive as to trust this flimsy door to protect him? Hagen's apartment was a room with two plastic chairs and a folding bed. The kitchen behind a low screen was filled with fast food wrappers and empty beer cans. A laptop with a movie on pause sat on the table nearby. The kitchen reeked of something rotten. Hagen himself stank of stale sweat and beer.
"Hey, dude. How have you been?" Gonzalo asked, fully aware of the futility of the question.
Mike looked more the worse for wear than back when he'd started his boxing training at Guillermo Ochoa's gym. And it wasn't an illness or an injury. He just looked absent. His eyes didn't even betray any interest in his friend's visit. Gonzalo wouldn't have been surprised if Hagen had asked him who he was or what he needed here.
"Man, I'm fine, just fine," Hagen muttered. "Sorry I haven't called or written you. Lots of stuff to do. Didn't have any time."
Gonzalo took in the empty and filthy ambience.
"I can see you've had a lot to do, sure. Bro, how come you live here in the first place? How do you even walk these streets?"
I don't walk around much. But the rent's cheap, and it's a good location. There's this tower just nearby. A landmark, isn't it? There was one just like it in one of the Fallout installments."
"A good location for what exactly? You don't go anywhere, do you?"
Hagen tried to gather his wits together. "The neighborhood is nothing to write home about. That much is true. But I've got some very nice neighbors, blood. When they found out I could repair electronics, they offered me a job. There's an electronic shop nearby, you know?" Gonzalo couldn't believe his ears.
"Bro, what the hell? An electronic shop? Really? You're a fighter. 5 minutes short of a champion."
"I used to be one."
"You'll be one once again,"
Gonzalo raised his voice.
"Especially if you stop horsing around and eating yourself alive."
He had initially wanted to have a word with Hagen and give him a piece of his mind about a few things. Even if his friend's strange ailment hadn't been his fault, he should have warned everyone that his health was failing and canceled the fight. However, now that he was looking at an empty-eyed and uncommunicative Mike, Gonzalo just reached for his wallet and took out some cash.
"Actually, the reason for my visit was..."
Gonzalo offered him the bills.
"This. Your share. Not much, but... you know how business is these days." What share?
Hagen looked surprised. Have you lost your memory, too? Each one of us invested into the gym, you, me, and Wei Ming. So, we even managed to turn a profit this week. Not that much, as you can see, but a profit nonetheless.
Gonzalo placed the money on one of the surfaces. Hagen shook his head. I just can't. Come on, I owe you all. Bro, you owe us nothing.
We placed our bets on you and lost. It's not your problem.
Still, I talked you into it in the first place. Take it back.
The former Hagen emerged for a second. The one who was confident and edgy. The one who would enter the ring to win and not just participate. The one who would always stand by his word.
Gonzalo hastened to put the money away. Okay, I get it, you don't want your share. But why don't you come to the gym yourself? Did you give up on sports? Or did the doctor forbid you?
No, not really. Actually, the doctor told me I should try to get back to my old shape and see what happens next.
And your plan for accomplishing this is what exactly? To eat chips and watch movies? A great method, bro. Patent it before it's too late.
Hagen went red and closed the laptop. I do push-ups.
Push-ups? From the fridge?
Gonzalo eyed the squalid apartment with visible skepticism.
Mike, you're the only person responsible for your decisions, but I want you to know that we expect you.
Uh-huh, Mike nodded. He seemed reluctant to continue the conversation.
Oh, one more thing, Gonzalo brightened up. Old man Ochoa confirmed he was ready to move to Vegas just recently. He's arriving tomorrow. Imagine that. He'll be our boxing coach.
Even this piece of news proved unable to do anything about Mike's desire to keep wallowing in misery. He started walking towards the door, even though Gonzalo exhibited no intention to leave. Then Hagen realized that it looked as though he'd decided to get rid of his guest and blushed again.
Okay, bro. I won't be getting between you and whatever you're doing here, Gonzalo said.
Mike frowned. Don't think I've given up or anything, yet. Something's been going on with me.
How's Peter doing? Gonzalo asked, thinking that the something in question might concern Mike's uncle.
He's okay. We had that talk and I apologized, Hagen mumbled. He's back in Seattle.
Gonzalo sighed, patted his friend on the shoulder, and left.
Mike followed. The guys from the street had wasted no time dragging the grill closer to Gonzalo's car. One was sitting on the hood of the car, while another was leaning against a door and munching on a hot dog. The ketchup bottle was standing on the roof.
Your neighbors are quite something, Gonzalo observed.
They were the ones who'd offered me the job, Hagen said in an almost apologetic tone. They're nice guys if you don't piss them off. We're almost friends.
Hot damn. I remember a time when Mike Hagen was someone you wouldn't want to piss off, not some riffraff from the street. Another thing I remember is that one had to be a friend of yours to be recognized as a nice guy.
You're lowering your standards, bro.
Don't devalue yourself as a friend, Mikey.
Hagen stood silent for a moment, then said a brief goodbye and shut the door. Gonzalo shook his head and started toward his car without slowing down his pace.
Thanks for watching over my wheels, guys.
He took the ketchup bottle from the roof and placed it in the hand of the hot dog guy, then opened the door and got behind the wheel, exuding confidence.
Hey, who the hell are you?
One of the young men started to get aggressive. The other one jumped off the hood.
What you doing here, huh?
What's the difference, bro? Gonzalo replied, starting the engine. I'm already leaving before any trouble starts.
Gonzalo had established himself in Vegas before Wei Ming and Hagen. He'd found a good offer on renting a large space in Spring Valley and had offered his friends the opportunity to become co-owners.
Sure, there are lots of gyms and fitness centers in this area, he'd said, but they all have a common fault. They're too expensive.
Ours will be the cheapest.
The money barely covered the rent and the purchase of a ring and a couple of second-hand gym machines. The space used to house an arts workshop, so there were still paintings on the walls, and the floor was covered in spots of paint.
This is cool, Wei Ming had said. We won't even have to invest in the interior. People would box surrounded by art.
After a short discussion, they called their new place the Art Classes Gym. Nor was there any need of a new sign. Gonzalo just spray-painted the word gym on the old one.
Everything I do, I excel at, he said, admiring his graffiti.
Gonzalo's plan paid off. A cheap new gym started to attract customers in droves. The only catch was that low prices meant low profits. Nevertheless, he'd been planning to hunt for new fighters just here. Beginners were always short of cash, after all. He'd even planned on opening boxing classes for children and teenagers, but the paperwork involved would consume an unbelievable amount of time. Old Man Ochoa would always say that he'd wanted to retire from running a gym. When Gonzalo offered him a trainer's position in Vegas, he made his son manager, packed his bags, and left. Any elderly person would appreciate being needed, and in a big city to boot. When the School of Classical Boxing opened at the Art Classes Gym, it started to attract even more patrons. Ochoa felt like he'd shed a few decades. To be a coach in Vegas implied one would always be in the thick of it. Once he'd found out about the situation with Luke Lucas, he warned Gonzalo.
You know, even if you and Hagen are both innocent, bear in mind that Luke Lucas is a bit of a bulldozer. He'll never recognize his own mistakes. I've been told that was his usual tactic for reacting to any obstacle to his plans. He doesn't waste time asking questions or investigating. He just moves on. Right now, you're in the roadside gutter of his life, even if none of it is your fault.
I understand him, as a matter of fact. Trying to set things right with everyone would take a lifetime, and Luke isn't a spring chicken. He values every minute.
But what should I do? How could I prove?
You don't have to prove anything. Find a road of your own instead of being in the roadside gutter of his life.
A few days after his conversation with Mike, Gonzalo was standing next to Ochoa, watching two fighters spar in the Art Classes Gym's ring. The fighters were below average.
What they like is being seen, boxing, not boxing itself, the old coach suddenly said. All they want is to brag about it on Instagram.
Gonzalo stopped listening and nudged the old man with his elbow.
Look what the cat dragged in.
Hagen timidly opened the door and entered the gym. He lingered by the entrance, giving way to a sweaty, muscled fighter who shouldered him aside without so much as noticing him. He then cast a respectful look at the two hopeless amateurs who were hopping around the ring. Judging by Hagen's open-mouthed expression, those two must have looked like real pros to him.
Indeed, Ochoa sighed. I'd never have believed you could change one way and then another so quickly. That's what he'd look like when he'd first come to my old gym. 2 weeks later, he knocked out Juan with a single punch.
Do you think he'll manage to get back into shape? I've got plans for him.
Ochoa laughed.
I've no idea, really. I've never met anyone like Hagen. You can expect anything from him. I won't be surprised if he comes to us and says, Hey, I've been recruited by NASA and I have a rocket to Mars to catch tomorrow.
Hagen noticed Gonzalo and Ochoa and approached them.
Hi. Here I am. Let's fight.
Chapter 6. The Lock.
So, you want to hear another story, eh?
Borderlands 2. Local layabouts were constantly hanging out around Hagen's condo. Hagen had no recollection of any of them, so much as mentioning their jobs, let alone searching for a job or actually working. He couldn't even think of them as hardcore gangsters, They would dress and behave like a gang, but they were anything but the real thing. Hagen had had enough experience with real gangsters to tell the difference. The locals just kept hanging out near the local store all day long. Whenever they had the money, they'd buy jumbo packs of sausages and buns, roll out a barbecue grill, fire it up right next to the sidewalk, and grill hot dogs all day long. When Hagen had been a near champion, he'd have made the likes of them scatter just by knitting his eyebrows. But now he felt intimidated by their presence, and he didn't intimidate them one bit. They refrained from open hostility because Hagen's prison manners would normally hold them back, as well as the rumor that Shorty here used to be a fighter. They would huddle around the smoking grill and watch Hagen as he'd leave the store. No opportunity to start a conversation was ever wasted.
Yo, neighbor, what's up?
That was from a tall, lanky guy aged around 20 years old who'd always wear the same vest with a huge 13 on it. His friend would join the conversation next. He wore dreadlocks and had a cigarette behind each ear.
Hey, neighbor, won't you lend me a Jackson?
The rest would wait for Hagen to react. Mike didn't have that many $20 bills, either, and he'd always tell them as much, being perfectly honest.
How about a couple of sausages, then?
That would be the tall guy again. Hagen had been managing to get by on jokes and banter, but the requests to lend a Jackson kept sounding more and more like demands. The hot dog cooking would occasionally involve loud music and explode into spontaneous block parties. All the neighborhood would gather around. The tall and lanky dude knocked on Hagen's door once.
Yo, neighbor! Not borrow a Jackson?
I'm sorry. I'm down and out myself, Hagen replied through the door.
Okay. Then how about joining us for a beer?
Hagen pondered it for a short while and decided to accept the invitation. Just like Hagen had suspected, the tall guy didn't just invite him over for a beer and some hot dogs. His name was Stripper. Once they'd had a cold one each, he asked Hagen,
I hear you used to be a boxer. Could you teach me how to fight?
Since the tone of the voice was the same as Stripper had used to ask for $20, Hagen just continued with the banter.
Hey, I hardly remember how to fight after all this time.
Stripper nodded.
That can happen. Oh, and didn't you say you were a programmer or something?
Well, I'm more of a hardware expert, but I can reinstall an OS or do a virus scan. That's no problem at all.
Same difference. My man here has a problem, you see. There's some shit stuck in his laptop. Can you take a look at it?
The man in question appeared instantly. The guy with the dreadlocks, predictably enough. He shoved a laptop into Hagen's hands. The Kensington lock had a metal cable in it. The other end was connected to a torn-out piece of plywood, obviously a stolen item. However, Hagen couldn't refuse to help Stripper at that point. The locals could have made his life a lot harder, and he didn't feel like moving to a different neighborhood. I need tools. Hagen finally thought of a response. I can't do anything without them. This didn't deter anyone. Hagen's neighbors took him to a nearby street where there was a small business with gadget fix shop on it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.